All right. How's everyone doing? Please grab a seat if you haven't already. How was dinner? How was dinner, guys? Good?
Yeah. Nice. Well, you guys are really in for a fantastic treat this evening because you're about to hear from one of the most insightful economic historians in the conservative movement, Dr. Burt Folsom, of course. Dr. Burt Folsom has worked tirelessly to expose the truth about America's economic history to teach the next generation of free enterprise advocates the policies and practices that created the strongest and most fair economy in the world. He has been a college professor at many places, including Hillsdale College in the Lower Peninsula of Michigan, where he still serves as Distinguished Fellow. He has written 10 books, including The Myth of the Robber Barons, which you'll all receive a copy of today, which is published by Young America's Foundation and will soon be in its 9th edition. Dr. Folsom is also the author of New Deal or Raw Deal, which describes President Franklin Roosevelt's disastrous New Deal program, which attacked free enterprise and slowed down America's recovery from the Great Depression of the 1930s. Dr. Folsom received his PhD in history from the University of Pittsburgh, and he appears regularly on Fox News. He's the longest-serving speaker for Young America's Foundation. Please join me in welcoming the conservative movement's historian, Dr. Burt Folsom.
Thank you. Good to be with you. Good to be with you and talking with such a fine group of high school students. I'm especially interested because my topic today has to do with the United States and the way people look at the United States and how in my generation it was, we were proud to be an American, and how there's been so many attacks on the United States that there isn't that way as much. And so I think it's good for always to sit back and remind ourselves, what makes America unique? What is there in America in its past that makes us special? I have three things that are unique with the United States that I want to talk with you tonight. And the first one is, number one, the end of slavery began in the United States. The end of slavery began in the United States. Now, today we look at slavery as just a preposterous institution, immoral, and totally against freedom. And after all, this is a free enterprise group. It's a conference. Nothing could be more contrary to free enterprise than slavery. Instead of a voluntary exchange of products, someone owns someone, and that labor belongs to the slave owner. Yet, even 200 years ago, that was taken for granted. And if you go 250 years ago, completely slavery was accepted. From the beginning of civilizations, we've had slavery. Every society at every time has had slaves. Even societies that have been relatively free, I'm thinking of the Greeks and the Romans. You know, Aristotle said some people are fit to be free and some people not so bright, they belong as slaves. It's a system that fits the natural order of things. Now, usually the way it worked out is that you had winners in battle conquering losers, because war is a constant state in humankind. And so winners and you have a clash. The winners defeat the losers. The losers then become slaves of the winners. Sometimes the winners would just take, like, the attractive women as mistresses or prostitutes. They would take the men for physical labor to defend the city. There would always be famine after a war, or almost always, because you can't be planting crops in the middle of a war. And so often the losers, you'd wipe out the losers with a famine. That would be common. Starvation would hit. That would, by the way, from the standpoint of the winner, be a good thing, because the losers just got wiped out even more. So they're not going to be able to launch a new assault against you. And then you have a lot of their people as slaves. The alternative to that you do see sometimes is the losers are allowed to maintain their existence where they are, but they have to pay huge high taxes and reparations which means they're not officially slaves. But they're not much better than slaves because of the huge taxation that they have to pay to the winners. And that's the good alternative. The bad one, again, is that you are enslaved directly. Your women are taken, your men are killed off or taken, and that is the institution as it went all the way through the 1700s. The end of slavery began in the United States, and part of that is because it was, I guess it was sort of inevitable with our Declaration of Independence that we believed in so strongly. We believed that people were meant to be free. The Bible helped us see this. And, you know, you look at these scriptures in the Bible that impressed many early Americans. From the book of Galatians in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul wrote the following. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Therefore, do not be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. That gets you thinking, doesn't it? And he also wrote, hey, there is neither Jew nor Greek, slave or free, male or female, for you are all one in Jesus Christ. In other words, they're not differentiating in the sight of God whether somebody's slave or free, male or female. You stand before God in sort of an equal way. And all of this began to take its toll on the founders who are reading this over and saying, I just don't think the institution of slavery squares with this. Now, we'd already committed, many people had committed themselves, and they already owned slaves. George Washington was in this position. He said, I don't like this. But he thought, he had 300 slaves. I can't free my slaves, because if I do that, then they will not. They only are prepared for plantation agriculture. They can't do other types of chores. You say, well, then they could do plantation agriculture. Yes, they could, but then who owns slaves are going to bring the free blacks in with them? You're not going to get this. And so what we have is a situation where, remember our Venezuelan student said he was caught between a rock and a hard place? That's where Washington was caught. The founders, though, they looked at the Declaration of Independence. And it's good to just ponder that. We hold these truths to be self-evident. Self-evident, mind you, that all men are created equal and are endowed by their Creator, endowed by God, with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, right? Thou shalt not kill. Therefore, you have a right to life. Thou shalt not steal. You have a right to your stuff. All of this consistent with the Bible, with their interpretation of those scriptures I read you in Galatians and others. And the founder said, I believe this is the best direction to go, and the institution of slavery doesn't fit. Yet, we're bound to a union here with 13 colonies. We're states. And so we tried to get slavery abolished by Congress, and we failed. Why? Virginia didn't like it. Washington, Thomas Jefferson was governor of Virginia, and he, with George Washington's help, tried to get Virginia to go free, and they couldn't get it through the legislature. And so what happened was some of the southern states went against freedom, and 8 northern states took votes in their state and abolished slavery. Even though that meant freeing people who many of the slave owners had paid money for, and they said, but this is really the direction we ought to go. Now, some resisted, but they didn't have the votes. 8 states in 15 years, by 1804, voted for freedom. And what that meant was we have a chunk of the United States which is a beachhead for freedom. Slavery, which had dominated the world, is now in the United States, the first country forbidden in certain areas of the country. You know, I say, well, you know, people always say, well, yeah, but some areas had it. I liken it this way. If each nation is like a person, you have 100 people, say 100 nations, and everybody's blind on slavery, right? The Greeks were blind. The Romans were blind. Everybody was blind. And the United States could half see it. We had one eye. But if you have one eye, you can still lead in a direction. And we led in the direction of freedom, and the other 99 nations are beginning to follow us. So that in the 1800s, slavery was virtually abolished everywhere in the West by the 1880s. That is 100 years after the United States finally said, slavery no more. At least in some states, we're going to have it no more. The whole Western civilization had joined within 100 years. The impact of the United States on Western civilization, tremendous. Point number one, the end of slavery began with the United States. Point number two. The United States saved Europe and much of the world after World War II. That's something you don't hear much. The United States saved Europe and much of the world after World War II. And that isn't even talking about what happened during World War II. Or the United States with the critical factor in Hitler's defeat. So put that aside. I'm not talking about the end of the war because there's a uniqueness to this. Let me explain. World War II, it begins with Pearl Harbor for us. We're dragged into it. This isn't a war we said, boy, do we need to fight this war. We have all this to gain. We were not that way. We didn't do it, but we were attacked at Pearl Harbor. Germany then declared war on us. And we're at war. So we're on England and France's side. We're against Germany. And Germany and Austria are leading the charge against us. And we've got this big battle. And we're underway in 1941. 4 years later, 1945, the war's over. The United States has prevailed. And guess what's on the mind of the soldiers that are coming home? Here's a clue. In 1945, the war is over. In 1946 is the biggest year in United States history for marriages. In 1947 is the biggest year in U.S. history for babies born. 3 million.
Wow.
3 million babies born. Some of them are still around, and I'm one of them. My parents were married in 1946, and I was born in 1947. And so I came through school, and I just, you know, the teachers would sit there, we've never had a class this big before. The baby boomers were here at last. We had arrived on the scene, and that's what our parents wanted. That's what, you know, they wanted to settle down. 4 years before, my dad was in the war, and my mom was at home on the home front helping. They were just getting married and have a family and catch up. You know, my dad lost 4 years. They wondered if he was going to finish school before I was beginning it. Yeah, because it takes a while, and you're in your mid-20s by the time, because you sort of lost, in a way, 4 years to the war. That's what they wanted. And plus, we had a national debt that had increased ninefold to pay for the war. We were paying, with a lend-lease program, we were just giving stuff to England and even Russia, which was our ally during the war. We were giving stuff to help win the war, paying for it out of our own pockets. And now we have to begin to think about paying off the national debt, but not quite, because we have to look at Europe. Europe is in a state of famine. Germany has lost the war. The ground has been bombed. They haven't been able to plant crops. We have a death, an infant mortality rate of over 20% and rising. Old people are dying. A lot of the young people aren't getting adequate milk. They've got rickets. They've got diseases, deformities. All of this is coming. Does that sound familiar, like the history of wars? In the old days, what would have happened to Germany is obvious, isn't it? England and the United States and others would have come in, taken the manpower or woman power that we wanted, or taxed them, and then let the famine clear off the rest. That was the old formula. But the United States doesn't work that way. The United States that believes in freedom believes that people have value. That's what natural rights in the, against the slavery is all about. People have value. You have value, and you ought to have choice in what you want to do in your life. It stuns me when I go through the statistics. The United States said, we are going to help rebuild Europe. Even though they dragged us into the war, even our allies dragged us in. We're going to get to that. We're going to get to that. The United States, we can't have a plan yet until we get people fed. People are on the verge of starvation. What are we going to do? The United States, President Truman, and leaders, and then in concert with talking with people, said, we've got to send food to feed Europe or they're all going to starve to death. And we sent 10 million tons of wheat a year for 4 years to Europe, 2 million tons of corn. And what that meant was, we're all talking about it, the only way we can do this is if the Americans themselves eat much less, maybe 25% less food. I'm glad I said that after the dinner, you know. You'd feel guilty if I had done it. Now you got to fill up 25% less. That meant, and it was voluntary. Now there were some people who said, well, let's send a commissar around and check everybody's eating habits and see if they're sneaking food in their clothes. But we said, we're Americans. We don't just operate by dictatorship like that. Let's do it. And we reduced our consumption. Now, some people ate heartily anyway. You know how it is. But enough people went along with it that we actually were able to meet those quotas and send all that food to feed Europe. All of it. We did it. Our enemies, Germany, as well as the Allies. A lot of Americans said, I've got to get in on this. And so we have care packages. You may have heard of that. Care packages is a box of food that contains a lot of nutrients. Some of it's like powdered milk, you know, but a lot of it is different kinds of food that can keep one person alive for 10 days. A care package costs $150, in today's money, $150. My parents sent a care package. 3 million Americans in the first and second year sent care packages. This is something we did on our own. In other words, the government had the idea of the 10 million, and now Americans just on their own want to do this. I'm sure I probably would have preferred that they spend the money on toys for me. But they didn't. They got a care package, and they sent it off. And the creativity. There were these farmers in Texas that said, wait a minute, they'll need help the next year. Let's send them cattle, send them bulls and cows, milk the cows, and then have perpetual food so we're not having to send it next year. And they did. These Texas cattlemen sent over that. I love the story of the one guy, because you could write a note to people. You, like an American could write, you know, I hope you're able to use this food. We're thinking about you and want you to live. And one guy said, I hope you did that to Germany, where he had fought. And said, although I fought against the Germans, I don't want you to starve. And he put his name and address. And then it was a woman whose husband was killed in the war. And she had a daughter. And she wrote back saying, "We were enemies then. I hope we're friends now." After a little more correspondence, she was married to him. And I thought, that's one way to get the hunger problem. You simply get them out of Germany over here. And they're no longer foreign refugees. But there are all sorts of interesting stories because Americans cared. They did this on their own. Nobody forced them to do it, but we did. Here's the result, because that's the bottom line. What about all these care packages, all this food? An estimate. Now, this will only be an estimate, but I'm picking a low estimate. I'm picking a low one. In 4 years that we did this, the United States, we estimate, saved 10 lives per minute for 4 years. I've been speaking for 20 minutes. So that means we would have saved, if this had been done back in those years, I guess I was alive. I mean, I would have been, it wouldn't have been a good speech, but so that's 20 minutes at 10 a minute, so that's 200, right?
Yeah.
So in just this time that I spoke, 200 lives were saved in Europe by aid that the United States gave at a sacrifice to ourselves, at an increase to our national debt. We did it to people who are our enemies and those who are our friends too. And we did it to Japan. Japan got a lot of this too. Then comes the Marshall Plan. After 4 years, we said, okay, they're alive. Now we've got to get them being productive. We can't be feeding them forever. And so the Marshall Plan, which was done by Secretary of War, then it had changed to Secretary of Defense by this time, George Marshall, and he was a general during the war. He got this idea that we could send the money over to help with industry so that they could feed themselves. We had a commitment of 5% of our GDP, our national debt. We tacked on 5% to our national debt to give to the Europeans and to the Japanese too, to rebuild their cities and to get industries going. That 5%, if that were translated to today, 5% of the national debt would be over $1 trillion. We decided we care. We care about people. You're not just a useless life to us. We want to show you that. We want to show you what America's all about. And so my second point is, the United States saved Europe and much of the world after World War II. By the way, how many get that in your history courses? Have you had lectures on that? Well, good. Okay. But I'm glad some of you have. That's wonderful. That's one of what we need to see our country in history. We need to see it. And my third and last. Now, this third one, you may not think ranks up there with the first two. And if you can, you know, tell me that and I may rearrange everything. But the more I thought of it, the more I thought, yeah, I think it belongs. And I'll explain it. I'm going to make a case for it. Third, the United States saved itself and the world from an energy crisis. It was in the 1970s. The United States saved itself and the world from an energy crisis. Now, energy is obviously critical. I mean, transportation, cars, airplanes. Plus, it's a part of, you know, oil and plastics. It goes. You can't do manufacturing without good energy, oil content. You can't do transportation. Everything is damaged. Your economy comes to a virtual standstill without adequate energy. In the 1970s, we seemed to be running out of oil, point number one. And point number two, OPEC, those nations in the Middle East particularly, were jacking up the price of oil. So what we had were rising oil prices. And Americans, we were in the 70s floundering, trying to think of what to do about it. In 1976, Jimmy Carter ran for president saying, "The energy crisis is my issue. I stake my presidency on this issue because it's so important to Americans." And let me explain what he did. He, first of all, I got to quote him. He said, the energy shortage, see, it's a shortage of energy and rising prices. And, you know, this is good for a free enterprise talk, because obviously when you have shortages, prices go up. Energy shortage is the greatest, Jimmy Carter said. He's from Georgia, and he graduated from the Naval Academy, and, you know, was kind of an engineer. And he said, he was governor of Georgia. He said, the energy shortage is the greatest challenge our country will face in our lifetimes. See, so he's setting the stage. He agrees, hey, this is big stuff. Then he also said this. This is interesting. We could use up all the proven reserves of oil in the entire world by the end of the 1980s. We can use up all the proven reserves of oil in the entire world by the end of the 1980s. And he said, we cannot substantially increase our domestic production. It is fixed. It is running out. Follow the science. It's fixed and running out, and I'm an engineer. And I've talked with people. And the experts agree with me. This is it. And so he said, we've got to use more ethanol. And so we get ethanol, corn being converted to fuel. And then we get, in addition to the ethanol, we end up with the higher prices that we have to pay. We get solar energy being experimented with, windmills. All of this that we're seeing now was sort of jump-started in the late 70s under President Carter, because we're going to run out of oil. We were weak, and oil increased under Carter from $13 for a barrel to $37 a barrel. In other words, the price of oil tripled. What this means at the pump is something like this, about a dollar in today's money, about $1.50 a gallon to $4.50 a gallon, pushing $5. And Carter said, here's what we got to do. We've got to get substitutes, as I mentioned, like the ethanol. We need to import more oil. Now, get this one, which is interesting. We need to tax the oil drillers in the United States. Because he said we're running out. I mean, it's selfish to just pull it all out now. And besides, they're making all this money. See, OPEC raised the prices. Now these oil drillers are making windfall profits. So we tax the drillers. We put controls on some of the prices of oil. Getting the government in a big way. Some of you may have heard your parents talking about this. The speed limit was capped on highways at what? 55. Yeah, because we're going to save on oil by going slower, see? And they also said, we'll save lives. You know, and some people pointed out, well, you'd save even more lives if you'd make the maximum 30 miles an hour, right? Then you'd save even more lives. President Carter had that, though, and that was law for almost 20 years. We paid more money to OPEC. Jimmy Carter also said, turn your thermostats down in the winter. Don't use that. And he'd go around the White House wearing a sweater and all of this saying, I'm here to save on fuel and show you how to do it. The result was a disaster. First of all, foreign policy sometimes is downstream from bad economic policy. When you have bad economic policy and people see it, they then are more susceptible to attacking you. And although we'd had a change of regimes in Iran, it was a lot of that, you know, is, hey, these Americans are weak and we don't need to be having faith in them. And so Iran takes 50 hostages from our embassy. And every night on the news, we would see they would be calling us the great Satan and denouncing us and insulting us. And Carter really was virtually helpless in the midst of this as oil prices rose and the United States suffered. Now, in 1980, Jimmy Carter had an opponent in the Republican Party. Who was his opponent?
Ronald Reagan.
Ronald Reagan. And Ronald, I love Ronald Reagan. One of his lines here, he said, "There's more oil in Alaska than there is in Saudi Arabia. Let's go get it. Take all the taxes off the oil drilling." President Carter, when he heard that, said two things. He said, "That is, number one, immoral, and number two, obscene." And others boosted his argument and said, "You do that, and then the oil, you let these corporate oil people get all that money, and the price will go up to," Howard Metzenbaum, senator from New Jersey, said, $8 a gallon. And some were saying $10 a gallon. And then you know how the news cycle goes. Then somebody says 12. And it's all this. This is what's going to happen if you elect Ronald Reagan. Reagan would simply say this. A recession is when your neighbor loses his job. A depression is when you lose your job. And a recovery is when Jimmy Carter loses his job. And Carter, you know, then they say, "Listen, we're the experts. You went to Eureka College. Whoa, we are the experts over here. And you're trying to tell us that we can get more oil." And he said, "Absolutely." And he says, "We've got government programs in the midst of this that are going to solve it." And Carter and President Reagan said, "A government program is the nearest thing to eternal life we will ever see on this earth." And they said, "Is it true you were a bad student at Eureka College?" And he said, "If I get to be president, the good thing is I'll have my grades classified." They never seemed to be able to phase him. And once, by the way, when he was president, they said, again, they kept trying, "Is it true you were a C student at Eureka College?" And President Reagan, he had that way of just shaking his head, and he said, "Yeah, I sometimes wonder what I could have accomplished if only I'd studied harder." I shouldn't say that. I'm a college professor. I may deter all of you from going. Listen, this Reagan had an answer. Reagan was just congenial, but firm. But firm. Reagan is elected. Americans decide to take their chances on President Reagan. And what happens is, the first act of the first day, he immediately, with an executive order, removes all taxes and price controls off of oil and gas. There is a media outrage. It's hysteria. The price is going to go through the roof. Well, you know, it fluctuated around for a while. And then it started heading down. I said it was $37 a barrel. 5 years later, it's $14 a barrel. And the prices at the pump, I can still remember driving. I was driving for Hillsdale College, and I was going throughout Michigan. I thought, well, at 70 cents a gallon, you know, this isn't too bad. Because that's what the price was at the pump. It had formerly been, what, $4 and something. So President Reagan got the drillers out. They drilled. They found oil. Now, the critics said, "Oh, yeah, well, now we're just going to run out all the sooner." And that's where the final point of my story is. One more thing. And that is, Reagan accomplished something he didn't even know he was accomplishing. He solved the energy crisis forever. And here's how he did it. In 1981, the year that the controls came off, a relatively unknown oil driller by the name of George Mitchell, a son of a Greek immigrant whose dad ran shoeshine shops in Galveston, Texas. And he got to go to Texas A&M, and he was all happy. And he graduated from A&M, and he ended up getting an oil company. And Exxon and Chevron and the big oil companies said, "You know, Carter may be right. We can't get much oil." And he said, "Yeah, but you go up to the Barnett Shale in Fort Worth, and there may be a lot of oil underneath that shale." And they said, "Yeah, but we've tried getting around it underneath it and everything, and you can't blast through that shale." And Mitchell said, "How about I use an invention here called fracking?" And he took the sand, the water, the chemicals, and started blasting through that. Because, see, he had the incentives. The taxes were off of him, right? He put the incentives, Reagan did, into place. 16 years later, long after Reagan was president, Mitchell, who always said, he said, Chevron, Exxon, everybody told me, you're wasting your money. You're wasting your money. It'll never work. Just like they told Reagan, you're from Eureka College. You're not going anywhere. They said that to George Mitchell he wasn't going to be successful. He broke through, and he was one of the quickest billionaires in U.S. history. As he captured that natural gas, all that oil, the United States became, and we had been importing roughly half, almost half of our oil under Carter. With fracking, with the oil discoveries that no one could, had in, the experts had not anticipated, the United States became energy independent, and fracking became available to the entire world. And right now we have an estimated, what we call recoverable reserve of 118 years worth of oil. Now, it's not being done now because of policies, but it's there for the right politician to have the right policies. That cheap oil is readily available thanks to George Mitchell and Ronald Reagan 16 years earlier providing the incentive, which means if you have faith in people, which is what Reagan did, the people will often come through for you more than you ever expect. Those are three things. We solved the energy crisis forever. Now, forever is long, for 118 years. We solved the energy crisis. We saved the world, at least Europe, in World War II, and the beginning of the end of slavery. That is what the United States has done. You are Americans. This is part of your heritage. And it's not done by experts. I mean, I went to the University of Nebraska. I mean, Ronald Reagan went to Eureka College. Ron Robinson, but we have ideas. We have a vision. I mean, different kinds of visions. Ron Robinson, who started YF, said, I wanted to teach, in my case, I wanted to teach history. I want to help the next generation get the ideas that will help keep America strong for the next generation. And that's what I want to do. And, I got together with Ron Robinson because his idea was, I'm not getting good treatment of economics, politics, or America in the campus, so I'm going to set up a group where we can bring speakers in to talk to students and try to give them what they're not hearing on the campuses. Ron's just a guy whose father was a grocer in Buffalo, New York. I mean, Governor Walker, who came in, was a guy from Delavan, whose father was a pastor in Delavan, Wisconsin. And he said, it's interesting what Governor Walker, he didn't say, I want to be governor. So I want you to think of the distinction here. He said, I want to do something as governor. See, a lot of people, boy, governor looks good on my resume. Walker said, I want to do something. I want to challenge the teachers union and improve the quality of life for everybody in Wisconsin. He did it. Now he's helping with running Young America's Foundation. You people have backgrounds similar to George Mitchell, right? And Reagan, all of us have an idea, something we want to accomplish that we can do in a free society. I want you to have the same advantages that I had, that Governor Walker has had, that Ronald Reagan had. Make this endure for at least another generation. I hope more than that, but it's up to you. You have a history and a heritage to be proud of. Thank you. Good.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Folsom. Students, if you have any questions for Dr. Folsom, you could go ahead and line up on this wall. And remember to state your name and what school you go to. Thank you.
Well, Hello, my name is Emily Levy. I'm from Scottsdale, Arizona, and I'm homeschooled.
Good,
and specifically,
Emily,
to your first point about slavery,
yeah,
when people talk about the 1619 Project, what's something that we can bring up these facts that you presented us with that can help either convince or help the other side learn more about what's true?
Right. I think that a lot of what I said there is in response, because I've seen that creep into the curriculum, the 1619 Project, which says that slavery is built into the American DNA. And what I'm trying to say is it was only ever a light part of the DNA. Did you know in the West, in the African traffic, only 4%, and by the way, Africans, it was winners sell the losers to slave traders. It was the same system. But only 4% came to the United States. And then we were the first, the end of slavery began in the United States. That's an odd part of our DNA, wouldn't you say? That we have a document of liberty in the Declaration of Independence. We follow it through on slavery, even though some nations abolished slavery completely before we did. We were the first one to end it somewhere. And I'd say that it's not part of our DNA at all, that freedom is part of our DNA, and that's why we freed the enslaved people, and many of them have come on to be very successful and enjoy our free society and have made tremendous contributions, which is wonderful. I think that's the way you respond. You've got to hit them because that's such a preposterous argument, and I never thought that it would be made. And a lot of major historians attacked it and said, oh, this is ridiculous, and I thought it would go away. I was wrong. It's here for a while. I hope it does go away. Maybe you can make it go away by challenging it effectively. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Sorry, I'm kind of short. Hi, I'm Holly. I'm from Gaithersburg, Maryland.
Okay.
I just had a pretty basic question. All of the like economists that I know, my brother's one, and like a couple of my friends' dads are, they're all very liberal. And so I was just wondering, like, of all the people to be liberal, I would think economists would be like not at all close to that, because they should know better than anyone. So I was just wondering, why do you think that that's the case?
That's a very good question. Now, I'm a historian, and I understand why they're liberal, because they're not rooted to data the same way that the economists are. And what happens is, I think with the economists, there are blind spots. And I'd say it's almost like slavery, I sometimes look at it. In other words, looking at it this way, until about 200 and some years ago, slavery was universally accepted by everyone. You know, it's like, we're going to die, we're going to pay taxes, we have slavery, and so on. And it was not even seriously challenged. The philosophers accepted it. And I think a lot of that happens with economics as well. In the case of economics, you get faddish sort of ideas that become current, and then you have people in government who like to hear these ideas because it helps the expansion of government to hear, oh, this program. See, it was like Jimmy Carter. We need to bring in ethanol. See, they didn't have, I guess, the common sense of the Texas A&M grad, George Mitchell. And so you think, oh, yeah, we have these reserves. We're using this much oil. We'll be out by the end of the 80s. And they get rooted, and they somehow, it becomes faddish. And then number two, they can't think outside the box. The best thinkers in the United States have been those who were able to think outside the box. And Reagan definitely on that issue did so. He did so also with the Russians and with the end of the Soviet Union shortly after his administration, because he thought, we can win the Cold War. Reagan said, my idea of the Cold War is we win, they lose. Right. Everybody else was trying to micromanage. Why don't we get Russia and help them here and then they won't? It'll be a deterrent from them launching a nuclear bomb. You've got to think outside the box, and a lot of economists get too rooted to a narrow set of data, and it's faddish, and they end up missing the boat. And I'm sorry, did you say it was your brother, Holly?
Yeah, one of my brothers, yes.
One of your brothers. But one of them maybe on the right side doing...
Oh, yeah.
Good. Good. Talk with him.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you for your question.
Hey, I'm Fernando.
Fernando, good.
Yes. My question for you is, what's the most important lesson history has taught us?
Ooh, boy. That's a tough one. And I'm not sure, you know, you've got such a good question. the most important lesson that history has taught us. I think I would go back to, because I want to get something that's a general lesson that has broad applicability, that freedom works. That would be it, that when we try freedom, we prosper. When we try controls and when we look to government, we tend not to prosper. And that one of the reasons that the United States caught on to that is, as I say, I think it's very biblical too. Because the way God is, it says, hey, I'm not forcing anybody. You know, you can accept me or not. And the freedom that the founders developed, I think, is part of the DNA of the United States. And I think the best lesson is it works, which is why we have three unique things that I brought up here that no other nation has been able to do, because it's a byproduct of freedom and our desire for freedom. That would be it. I'm sorry if that's so simple, but I just
think that's a good lesson. No, that was perfect. Lesson. Thank you.
Thank you.
We have time for just one more question.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Michael.
Michael.
Yeah, we met earlier.
Yes, we did.
Anyways, so this is a pretty basic question, but since you are a teacher at a public university or private university, you're a university
professor.
I have
taught at a public university.
Okay, well, this makes my question a bit more relevant here. So what do you think is the biggest problem with just American education as a whole?
Biggest problem with American education?
And how would you fix it in addition to that?
Good. Another good question. I think... I'd say the biggest problem is a tendency to centralize education and education decisions and have top-down bad decisions end up trickling down to lots of schools, and that education suffers tremendously because of that. Teachers' unions in that framework care more about the teachers than they do about the students. That's always a bad situation. We want politicians to care about voters. We want teachers to care about students. When you start a union and when you have top-down education from Washington, that very desirable connection tends to be lost. Adam Smith, you know, the great British philosopher and free market economist, said the ideal teaching situation, this always makes me nervous to say this, I'm going to say it, and I'm not going to say it like, so there. I'm saying it like I'm nervous. The ideal teaching situation is where the students pay the teacher for themselves for the education they are receiving. And the further you get away from that, the further you get away from a good educational system. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.